Hello everyone, and welcome to this seminar on Design for Manufacturing, DFM. In this seminar, I will show how designers, by using the DFM tools in ADS, will be able to create and transform any existing design they have into robust designs with one-pass success and high yield. In other words, I will show you how these DFM tools will help you create rock-solid circuits that will work and meet the specifications no matter what. By incorporating these design techniques in your design flow, both designers and managers will benefit. Designers will no longer have to worry whether or not their circuits will have to be redesigned, because it will make it from the first time. Now, managers don't need to be concerned with the high costs of multi-wafer runs. The designs will make a one pass with high enough yield, and it will meet the time to market. So, by integrating the DFM design tools into your design process, these are the values you will end up achieving. You will achieve first pass success, as I mentioned before. You will market your products first. You will have high yield, which translates to lower cost per chip. Your designs will be robust and high quality that are insensitive to process variation, to temperature variation, and to changes in the supply voltage. All these will translate to a tremendous amount of saving in both time and money. Let me now illustrate this DFM concept with a real example. What you see here are wafer probed results of conversion gain at 20 GHz for two MMIC upconverters. Both upconverters were placed on the same wafer and processed at the same time. The one on the left used standard design techniques. The one on the right side used DFM, or design of experiment techniques. Notice how the DFM results turned out much tighter with only 1.3 dB spread due to process variation. But if you look at the left side, the standard design techniques is very sensitive and it shows a 10 dB variation. Now, which of these two designs you would like to choose? So this clearly illustrates the power of DFM design technique. Let me now show you the steps in a typical DFM design process. First, we obtain the process parameters. We must know how these parameters change in the fabrication process. For example, capacitors, resistors change plus or minus 10% due to process variation. Width of lines, microstrip lines, change plus or minus half a micron due to the process variation. So these are important to obtain so you can do your DFM analysis as you're designing your circuit. Next, it would be nice to obtain a real statistical model of the active devices used in the design. The next step is starting the nominal design. Designers usually use optimization and design centering techniques to get their nominal design meet its specifications. Now, after the nominal design has been created, the next step is to run Monte Carlo yield analysis in order to verify the design yield and sensitivity to the process variations. If the yield turns out to be low and the spread, the output measure spread, is wide, then we move to the next step, which is using these DFM tools, the yield sensitivity histograms, which are derived from the Monte Carlo yield analysis by post-processing the data in ADS. And then we have another tool, the sensitivity analysis tool. And the third tool is design of experiments, DOE. It helps us find the matching network that is sensitive and causing problems in the design, or it helps us finding the components that are sensitive in the design. Not only that, it also, design of experiments also help us find the interactions between components in the designs. The interactions itself might be are the cause of the problem in the design. So these tools are invaluable. They are very, very important tools to use. And here I'm just briefly talking about it, but in the next sections of this seminar, I will in detail explain each tool and show a demo on how to use it in ADS. So the DFM tools in ADS help us to pinpoint and exactly find where the yield problem is originating from in our design. We can then focus all our efforts to fix this problem and improve the quality of our design. Having fixed the design, the next step is we can do a final design centering run and take the design for fabrication. This methodology is identical to what was used in converting this upconverter macro cell example that I talked to you about before. Next, I would like to share with you one of my early designs that kind of opened the door for me and got me very interested in the DFM design methodology. This example will help understand the DFM design concept better. It is a MIC design, MIC design, on alumina substrate. The dielectric constant is 9.9, height of the substrate is 25 mils. The device I have used was NEC67383 FET. The frequency spec is 2.4 GHz and the noise figure spec is 0.7 dB. At that time, 0.7 dB noise figure at 2.4 GHz was a challenging design to create. So to start the design, I went ahead and I got from the vendor the optimum noise match parameters from 2 to 4 GHz, and they're listed in the table here. I plotted them on the Smith chart as shown, from 2 to 3 GHz. And my task is to come up with a matching network, an input matching network that will take me to this locus of point to give me the optimum noise figure. Hopefully I can achieve the 0.5 dB at 2.4 GHz. So I went ahead and I used the standard design. This is not a wideband structure, so you can match it with two elements, a series line, open stub, or shorted stub, quarter wavelength, or open stub, quarter wavelength, and there is many other possibilities. So I decided to choose this topology number one, which is a series line with an open stub to take me to this point. So I went ahead and designed my what's called a rubolith, which is 10 times the size of the actual circuit. The actual circuit is supposed to be 1 inch. So this ruby is 10 inch by 10 inch. And you can see the series line and the open stub. And those are confettis just for tuning purposes. This is 50 ohm line and the blocking capacitor. The FET is supposed to land right here in the center. This is the bias for the gate. This is the bias for the drain. And this is the output matching network to maximize my gain and output return loss. So I went ahead and built the circuit, and I was looking forward to see in the lab if I can achieve that 0.5 dB noise figure that I simulated. And believe it or not, surprisingly, I went to the lab after I built this amplifier and I measured 8 dB noise figure. And I got very nervous and I said, what is wrong with this circuit? It's supposed, the simulation showed that I can get 0.5 dB noise figure. I mean, if I get 1 or 2, it's okay, maybe there's a problem, but 8 dB noise figure, what went wrong? There's something not right in this circuit.